Hello, anatomists. Michele Glass here, and our job for today is to continue the study of the endocrine system by looking at models. And so to begin, we're going to see there are three glands, remember, in the brain. So we're going to look at this overview to start, and then we'll look at some specifics. So remember here we have the hypothalamus. We have right below the pituitary gland. And then here we have the pineal gland. So that's not one we saw a whole lot of in our models. Here in the neck, we have the thyroid. And if you look closely, we can actually see the four parathyroid glands, which are positioned on the posterior side of the thyroid. Here we have the thymus, which we did not see on any of our models. We have on top of the kidney, the adrenal gland. And remember, you have two of these, one on top of each kidney. We have the pancreas. And then remember, we have the gonads. So I'm going to go ahead and write testes, which is the plural form, and ovaries, which of course is also the plural form. As we take a look at these glands, most of these that are shown here are considered primary endocrine glands, which remember means that their primary job is to produce hormones. But we do have a few that are listed here, which we can consider secondary. And we can abbreviate that with two and then a degree there. Secondary endocrine, because these organs, these gonads, have the primary job of actually making either sperm cells or egg cells. And then the production of hormones is secondary to that. We see that the thymus is also going to be classified as a secondary endocrine gland because this will atrophy in adults, in adulthood. And we'll be talking more about the thymus when we talk about the lymphatic system. So let's take a look at some more specific diagrams that we haven't seen yet. So let's look up at the hypothalamus a little bit more closely. And let's start by listing out the hormones that the hypothalamus produces. So we're going to see what's called the antidiuretic hormone, or abbreviated ADH, and oxytocin, which is abbreviated OXT, as actually being produced by neurons in the hypothalamus, but released at the neurohypophysis. So we'll come back to this as we progress through. The other thing to pay attention to is the hypothalamus is responsible for making what are called either releasing hormones or inhibiting hormones. And here we can collectively talk about these as regulating hormones. And what we'll see in our lecture is that the regulating hormones are really in charge of the adenohypophysis. So let's take a look here at our diagram, and this shows us the hypothalamus right here. And notice you have these neurons, these green colored neurons that are extending down into the neurohypophysis. So remember, these are the neurons that are actually producing ADH and oxytocin, and then the ADH and the oxytocin is actually being released into this capillary in what we can call the neurohypophysis. Remember, neurohypophysis can also be called the posterior lobe. And we're looking here at this whole gland, which is called the pituitary gland. So neurohypophysis and posterior lobe of the pituitary are the same. And then our adenohypophysis or anterior lobe of the pituitary are the same. We can also see the tissue that actually connects the pituitary gland to the hypothalamus, and we can call that the infundibulum. Now remember, hormones are going to be released into the bloodstream and travel through the body that way. And remember, the hypothalamus is really having this job of producing what are called regulatory hormones. And these then talk to specifically the adenohypophysis. And we see that they're located anatomically very close to each other. So it doesn't make sense for these hormones to be released into the bloodstream, travel to the big toe, and then back to the adenohypophysis. And so instead we see this connection of capillaries. So you have, let me get my laser here. We have a capillary bed here in the hypothalamus, and then we have a capillary bed here in the adenohypophysis. And notice that you have some blood vessels that are connecting these two capillaries together. And when you have this kind of a situation, we refer to it as a portal system. So these blood vessels here, we can actually just label as portal vessels. And we can talk about this whole connection of capillaries as the hypophyseal portal system. So hypophyseal is just another name for pituitary gland. And we see that in the term adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis. When we talk about the adenohypophysis, remember there are 7 hormones that are being produced. We're going to talk about these more in lecture, and we can talk about these as being tropic hormones, which basically means like turn on. So the adenohypophysis is going to be responsible for turning on a lot of other glands in the body. So you do need to be familiar with this list, and you need to be equally well-versed with both the full name and the abbreviation. So make sure you're writing those down. We're going to go into way more detail on these in the lecture. So for now, you just need to be able to connect which hormones are being produced by which gland. As we look at the neurohypophysis, remember the neuro there is talking about the neurons, the hypothalamus neurons that actually hang down into the posterior lobe of the pituitary gland. And that's going to be the cells that are releasing the antidiuretic hormone and the oxytocin. We've mentioned those earlier on the hypothalamus slide. So this is actually the reason why I like to use these terms adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis, because that term neurohypophysis really speaks to that connection between. So in this slide, we're looking specifically at our pineal gland. And the pineal gland is going to be producing the hormone melatonin. With all of these hormones, we will go into much more detail as we progress into this topic in lecture. Looking at the thyroid gland, we see the production of hormones called thyroxins. And that's really what I need you to know. We see that depending on the type of thyroxin, it can either use the abbreviation of T subscript 3 or T subscript 4. So we can talk about these as the T3s and the T4s. Calcitonin is a hormone that we've mentioned already in the course. That was something you studied in more detail in AMP1. So that will be coming back in this semester as well. When we are talking about the thyroid gland, we're talking about this structure right here. So pretty much this is the thyroid. And the thyroid has 2 lobes. So we're going to talk about this as our left lobe. Remember, we're doing the diagram or the patient's left and right. So it should be mirror image to you. You can see too, like right in the center, this area right here is going to be called the isthmus. So in addition to naming the thyroid, we do need to be able to pick out the lobes as well as the isthmus. When we look at the posterior view of the thyroid, we see these four little glands called parathyroid glands. All right, you all, so we are in the middle of naming our parathyroid gland. And remember, we do have four of these, so we can see these on the posterior side of the thyroid. And the hormone that's being produced here is pretty easy for us to connect. It's the parathyroid hormone, abbreviated PTH. And again, this is another one that you studied in AMP1, so it should be pretty familiar. Moving on, the next gland that we're going to be looking at is called the adrenal gland. And remember, we have the adrenal cortex. So cortex means outermost. And the adrenal medulla we've been talking about already in our discussion of chapter 16, autonomic nervous system. And the medulla here means innermost layer. When you look at the adrenal cortex, notice that you have cortico in a lot of the names for these hormones. So mineral corticoids is like a group of hormones, so we can abbreviate them as MCs. And aldosterone is the example that we're going to spend the most time talking about in this course. Glucocorticoids, we can abbreviate as big GCS. Little s. And probably the one that you're going to hear about the most here would be cortisol. And then the other hormone that's coming from adrenal cortex would be the androgens. So thinking here about hormones that are responsible for a lot of the secondary sex characteristics that we see in male bodies. Adrenal medulla, we've already talked about again in the sympathetic nervous system. So we're already familiar with epinephrine and norepinephrine that are released there. As we look here at our adrenal glands, remember you have two, one on each kidney. And remember we have the cortex as the outermost tissue, and then we have the medulla as the innermost tissue. So remember, medulla with an A ending is our singular version of the word, whereas medulla with the AE ending is the plural form. Now, as we look at the layers of our adrenal gland, we can see that our cortex is divided into three layers. And so we have what's called the zona glomerulosa. And this is going to be then, of course, our outermost cell layer. We have the zona fasciculata. So this is our middle layer of our cortex. And then we have our zona reticularis. And then we can see our medulla layer here, which is the innermost. So we're going from outermost to innermost in this diagram. Now what we see as we are looking at these different layers, they're being named based on either how they look or how the tissue is organized. So we just need to be able to label those. The next gland that we're going to look at is the pancreas. So as we look at the pancreas, we're going to see that there are four different major hormones that are being released from the pancreas. And we're going to be really focusing in on, glucagon and insulin. So these will be the ones that we speak about most often. Now what we'll see is there's four different types of cells producing these different hormones. So the glucagon is being produced from what are called alpha cells. And then the insulin is being produced by what are called beta cells. Now here, pay attention, because this is going to be a question on your lecture, departmental final exam. So you do want to make sure that you're keeping this information straight. When we look at somatostatin, this is actually similar to or another version of growth hormone, inhibiting hormone, growth hormone, inhibiting hormone. And we'll see this being produced by what are called delta cells. And then the pancreatic polypeptides are being released by what are called F cells. So we do need to kind of keep up with this relationship of focusing in primarily on glucagon and insulin. Now, as we look at the pancreas, this tissue here, of course. Now, the pancreas can have or does have two different functions. So when we talk about the pancreas, we do see it has this close relationship here to the small intestine. And it's going to have what are called pancreatic islet cells, as in like islets, as in like islands. And these are the endocrine cells. So endocrine, remember, is talking about release of hormone into the bloodstream. Surrounding these pancreatic islets, we have what are called pancreatic. Let me do that a little bit nicer. Acini cells, and these are exocrine cells. So endocrine means hormone into the bloodstream, whereas exocrine means into a duct. So never going into the bloodstream. So we have actually in the middle of the pancreas here, we have what's called the pancreatic duct. And notice that it opens up into the small intestine. So when we study the digestive system, we'll see the pancreas is important in producing a lot of buffers and digestive enzymes that are going to be part of that exocrine function. Moving along, emphasize on this model here, we see again the thymus. The thymus, remember, is classified as secondary structure. It's producing the hormone thymosine, and we do see, remember, that it atrophies during adulthood. So that means it slows down its function, it stops producing thymosine as we get older. The ovaries, remember, are located in female bodies, and this has a secondary, all of these are secondary endocrine structures or glands. Let's use the word gland here. And remember, that means it has some other job, but also part of its job is to make hormones. So the ovaries, we see in female bodies producing the hormones estrogen and progesterone. And we see in male bodies, the testes, that's the plural form of the word, and producing the hormone testosterone. And that should do us for our models. Stay tuned for some practice videos. And as always, take care of yourself and each other.